Macmillan Audio presents The Facemaker, a visionary surgeon's battle to mend the disfigured soldiers of World War I. Written by Lindsey Fitzharris. Narrated by Daniel Gillies. He would show himself to the little guys, and to their mothers and fathers, and brothers and sisters, and wives and sweethearts, and grandmothers and grandfathers, and he'd have a sign over himself, and the sign would say, "Here is war," and he would concentrate the whole war into such a small piece of meat and bone and hair that they would never forget it as long as they lived. Dalton Trumbo. Johnny got his gun. Only the dead have seen the end of war. George Santayana, 1922. A note to the listener. A significant challenge for any nonfiction writer is not to overwhelm the reader with too many details, something that is easily done when charting the immense scale of events that took place between 1914 and 1918. The Facemaker is by no means a definitive history of plastic surgery during the First World War. Nor is it a comprehensive biography of Harold Gillies, the surgeon who dedicated himself to rebuilding the faces of soldiers maimed during that time. For that, there are many articles and books written by scholars who have devoted their entire careers to these subjects, as my endnotes will attest. Rather, what follows is an intimate account of the daily struggles Gillies and his team faced at the Queen's Hospital, as well as the men who suffered the double trauma of injury on the battlefield and the painful process of recovery. In their own time, disfigured soldiers were often hidden from public view. The decision to include their photographs in the PDF that accompanies this audiobook was not made lightly. I consulted various experts, including a disability activist with a facial disfigurement. The photos are undoubtedly graphic, and many people will find them difficult to view. But it is impossible to grasp the severity of these men's injuries and the reactions they elicited without seeing their faces. Equally, it is hard to appreciate fully the skill with which Harold Gillies and his team reconstructed soldiers' faces without seeing the surgical progress chronicled in these photographs. However, there is an exception. I have not included pre- or post-operative images of injured men who died in Gillies' care, as the reconstruction was never completed. It bears stressing that this is a work of nonfiction. Anything that has been attributed to historical document, be it a letter, diary, newspaper article, or surgical casebook, any descriptive references to gestures, facial expressions, emotions, and the like, are based on first-hand accounts. It is my hope that through the telling of this tale, readers and listeners will gain a new perspective on the terrible consequences of trench warfare and the private battles that many men fought long after they put down their rifles. Prologue. An Unlovely Object. November 20, 1917. Brilliant shards of crimson and gold pierced the eastern sky as dawn broke over Cambrai. The French city was a vital supply point for the German army positioned 25 miles from the Belgian border. On the dewy grass of a nearby hillside, Private Percy Clare of the 7th Battalion, East Surrey Regiment, was lying on his belly next to his commanding officer, awaiting the signal to advance. 30 minutes earlier, he had watched as hundreds of tanks rumbled over the soggy terrain toward the wire entanglement surrounding the German defense line. Under the cover of darkness, British troops had gained ground, but what had the appearance of a victory soon deteriorated into a hellish massacre for both sides. As Clare prepared himself for this dawn attack, he could already see the motionless, broken bodies of other soldiers scattered across the blasted landscape. "I rather wondered if I should even see another sunrise over the trenches," he later recorded in tightly lettered script in his diary. The 36-year-old soldier was no stranger to death. A year earlier, he had been holed up in the trenches of the Somme, where tedious stretches of inactivity were punctuated by frenzied bouts of terror. Every few days, wagons arrived to exchange rations for corpses, but the sheer number of bodies made it impossible to keep up. They lay in trenches where they'd fallen, one soldier remembered. Not only would you see them, but you'd be walking on them, slipping and sliding. These rotting bodies became structural fixtures, lining trench walls and narrowing passageways. Arms and legs protruded out of the breastwork. Corpses were even used to fill in blasted roads that were essential for military vehicles. One man recalled that they just shoveled everything into the crater and covered it over with dead horses, dead bodies, anything to fill up and cover it over and keep the traffic going. Common decencies were abandoned as burial parties tried to keep pace with the body count. The dead hung like laundry over barbed wire, covered inches deep with a black fur of flies. The worst, remembered one infantryman, was the bubbling mass of countless worms which oozed from the corpses. The horror of these sights was exacerbated by the stench that accompanied them. The sickly sweet scent of rotting flesh permeated the air for miles in all directions. A soldier could smell the front before he could see it. The stink clung to the stale bread he ate, the stagnant water he drank, the tattered uniform he wore. "Did you ever smell a dead mouse?" asked Lieutenant Robert C. Hoffman, a veteran of the First World War, when warning Americans against involvement in the Second, a little over two decades later. This will give you about as much idea of what a group of long-dead soldiers smell like, as will one grain of sand give you an idea of Atlantic City's beaches. Even after the dead were buried, Hoffman recalled, they smelled so horribly that some of the officers became extremely sick. Claire had grown accustomed to the dead, but not to the dying. The tremendous amount of suffering he had witnessed was etched into his mind. Once, he'd stumbled upon two Germans cowering in a trench, their chests ripped open by shrapnel. The soldiers bore an uncanny resemblance to each other, leading Claire to conclude that they were father and son. The sight of their faces, ghastly white, their features livid and quivering, their eyes so full of pain, horror, and terror, perhaps each on account of the other, haunted him. Claire had stood guard over the wounded men, hoping that medical assistance would arrive soon, but eventually he was forced to move on. Only later did he discover that a friend named Bean had thrust his bayonet into their bellies after Claire had quit the scene. "My indignation consumed me," Claire wrote in his diary. "I told him he would never survive this action, that I didn't believe God would suffer so cowardly and cruel a deed to go unpunished." Shortly afterward, Claire came upon his friend's decomposing remains in a trench. Now, as he peered out over Cambrai's battlefield from his position on the hillside, Claire wondered what fresh horrors awaited him. In the distance, he could hear the faint staccato of the machine guns and the whistle of shells as they sailed through the air. Claire wrote that upon impact, the earth seemed to quake, at first with a jerk, like a giant startled out of sleep. Afterwards, with a continuous trembling communicated to us through our bodies, lying there in contact with it. Shortly after the shelling began, his commanding officer gave the signal. It was time. Claire fixed his bayonet to his rifle and cautiously rose to his feet along with the other men in his platoon. He began marching down the exposed hillside. Along the way, he passed a stream of wounded men, their faces blanched with terror. Suddenly, a shell burst overhead, temporarily obscuring the scene with a cloud of smoke. Once it cleared, Claire saw that the platoon ahead of his own had been destroyed. A few minutes later, we moved on, stepping over the mutilated bodies of our poor comrades, he wrote. One corpse in particular drew his attention. It was a dead soldier who was entirely naked. Every stitch of clothing blown from the body, a curious effect of a high explosive burst. Claire's own platoon continued to advance, passing through the carnage on the way to its intended target, a strongly fortified trench protected by a wide belt of barbed wire. As they drew closer, the Germans began raking them with bullets, their machine gunners and riflemen firing from several positions at once. Suddenly, Claire felt woefully underprepared. How absurd it seemed to be advancing just one thin line of khaki against the immensely strong entrenchment from which now belched a continuously increasing rifle fire. Claire inched forward, weighed down by the heavy pack of supplies that all infantrymen were required to carry. These packs, which could weigh as much as 60 pounds, contained everything from ammunition and hand grenades to gas masks, goggles, shovels, and water. Claire negotiated tangles of barbed wire, keeping low to the ground to avoid the shower of bullets flying overhead. Then, 700 yards from the trench, he felt a sharp blow to the side of his face. A single bullet had torn through both his cheeks. Blood cascaded from his mouth and nostrils, soaking the front of his uniform. Claire opened his mouth to scream, but no sound escaped. His face was too badly maimed to even arrange itself into a grimace of pain. From the moment that the first machine gun rang out over the Western Front, one thing was clear. Europe's military technology had wildly surpassed its medical capabilities. Bullets tore through the air at terrifying speeds. Shells and mortar bombs exploded with a force that flung men around the battlefield like rag dolls. Ammunition containing magnesium fuses ignited when lodged in flesh, and a new threat, in the form of hot chunks of shrapnel, often covered in bacteria-laden mud, wrought terrible injuries on its victims. Bodies were battered, gouged, and hacked, but wounds to the face could be especially traumatic. Noses were blown off, jaws were shattered, tongues were torn out, and eyeballs were dislodged. In some cases, entire faces were obliterated. In the words of one battlefield nurse, the science of healing stood baffled before the science of destroying. The nature of trench warfare led to high rates of facial injuries. Many combatants were shot in the face simply because they'd had no idea what to expect. They seemed to think they could pop their heads up over a trench and move quickly enough to dodge the hail of machine gun bullets, wrote one surgeon. Others, like Claire, sustained their injuries as they advanced across the battlefield. Men were maimed, burned, and gassed. Some were even kicked in the face by horses. Before the war was over, 280,000 men from France, Germany, and Britain alone would suffer some form of facial trauma. In addition to causing death and dismemberment, the war was also an efficient machine for producing millions of walking wounded. The loss of life was also greater than in any previous war, due in part to the development of new technologies that enabled slaughter to occur on an industrial scale. Automatic weapons allowed soldiers to fire hundreds of rounds a minute at distant targets. Artillery became so advanced that some long-range weapons required their operators to take the curvature of the earth into consideration in order to remain accurate. The Germans' largest siege cannon, the dreaded Paris gun, pummeled the French capital with 200-pound shells from a distance of 75 miles. Infantry weapons had also advanced considerably in the years leading up to the First World War, providing many times the rate of fire of those used in previous wars. The military historian Leo van Bergen notes that this, in combination with advances in artillery, meant that a company of just 300 men in 1914 could deploy firepower equivalent to that of the entire 60,000-strong army commanded by the Duke of Wellington at the Battle of Waterloo. Beyond developments in the traditional hardware of guns, bullets, and shells, were two ghastly innovations brought on by scientific advances. The first was the Flammenwerfer, or flamethrower, which produced an appalling shock for the uninitiated. It was first used by the Germans, most notably against the British at Hooge, in 1915. The portable device belched forth a stream of burning oil that destroyed everything within range, sending men scurrying from the trenches like mice from burning haystacks. Its jets of liquid fire left victims with severe burns over their entire bodies. One soldier watched in horror as flames seared a fellow comrade. His face was black and charred like a cinder, and the upper part of his body scorched and cooked. The second, and perhaps more psychologically devastating innovation, was chemical weapons. The first large-scale lethal gas attack came on April 22, 1915. When members of a special.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.